on return, we will deal with this small concept of Ventanli. Because one, I say small concept because Ventanli you find essentially talks about situations of acts which are done thoughtlessly, without putting any thought to it, and without having any regard to the consequences. These are the only two aspects to bring out the state of mind. Interestingly, I think somebody's mic has not been muted. I can hear their pet asking for attention. Anyway, so now here is a state of mind which talks about there being thoughtlessness, a state of mind where the mind is not being applied. Isn't it an interesting contradiction of sorts? That a state of mind which is talking about where the mind is not being applied thoughtlessly and without bothering about the consequences. Now it has got an interesting kind of a relationship with the next state of mind which I wish to bring forth, and that is Rashi. The commonality between these two is that in a rash act as well, the consequence, there also there is the aspect of consequence. But the difference between the two is this, that as far as Rashi is concerned, a dangerous act is being undertaken, but conscious of the fact that there could be a consequence of this kind. Here, as far as Ventanli is concerned, it's a thoughtless act where you are not bothered about the consequence. But there, in a rash act, you are aware that you are going to indulge into an act which is dangerous, and you also have knowledge that probably because of that, a consequence would be that you may cause injury. So that is the subtle difference which is there, as far as Rashi is concerned and as far as Ventanli is concerned. And invariably you find this word Rashi, again, as I had at that point of time illustrated between corruptly and maliciously, here rashly is generally, you find, used alternatively with negligence. Rashly or negligently, you will find provisions using this alternatively. Again, these are two different concepts altogether. Certain amount of color, as I had earlier also said, because they are used in the provision, certain amount of color may draw from each other, but they are essentially different concepts. Now, which are those sections? Those sections which you will find are normal sections which you probably, most of you have done cases in relation to that. 279-304A, which comes straight away to the mind. You will find the use of this. 336, 337, 338. And now when I discuss the concepts out here, because 304A, you know, is a scenario where a death results. Now, when a death results, interesting scenarios happen. States of mind need to be considered very carefully at this point of time. The mensriya, which I spoke of earlier, the intention which I spoke of earlier, the knowledge which I spoke of earlier, all these come into play the moment a death is caused by an act. How to draw a line of difference between a death which is caused by a rash and negligent act, or a death which would be caused otherwise, which will bring in the interplay of other provisions of law. For that, we need to visit what every trial court lawyer dreams of doing a trial of. In my days, that used to be the ultimate dream. Now, of course, economic offenses have taken a front seat. But in my days, it used to be something to do a murder trial. So if you've done a murder trial or if you're doing a murder trial, means, okay, you have come of age as far as criminal law is concerned. So let us visit those provisions, 299 and 300. So 299, 300, 304, 304A. These are the provisions which by and large will cover the ambit or cover the areas which I will now essentially propound on. Short propositions, but I will try and make myself as clear as possible. Culpable homicide. That is one word which you people, these are two words which will ring into the mind when we deal with 299 and 300. Culpable homicide means something which is punishable. A human death which is punishable. Culpable means punishable. Homicide is a human death. Killing of a human being. Or the manner in which a human being dies. Death of a human being. Take it in that form. So, 299 deals with the definition of culpable homicide, which is the genus. And 300 talks about the species, which is murder. So it is culpable homicide amounting to murder. One is culpable homicide which is defined, the other is culpable homicide amounting to murder. So why it is saying culpable homicide amounting to murder, which means that there must be culpable homicide which does not amount to murder as well. So there are scenarios where there will be homicide which is punishable but will not be murder because it does not satisfy the criteria which are enumerated between these two sections. To a certain extent, I can say that. For that, you have a provision which is not essentially a defining provision. 304 does not define anything. 304 is only providing a sentence in relation to a scenario which would be a punishment for culpable homicide not amounting to murder. Okay? So let us see what is this. So this 304A which I am talking of, this 304A will be something which will not come within the ambit of 299 and 300. It will not be something which will come into the ambit of culpable homicide amounting to murder or culpable homicide not amounting to murder. It will be something more, something which will be carved away from this. So what is it that, broadly speaking, because I don't intend reading the sections out here and, you know, going into a, I am trying to explain it as I understand it from the point of view of practicing it. Broadly, how do you understand it? In terms of the concepts which I have explained to you guys, when you look at the provisions 299 and 300, you will find within it there are three aspects to it. One, intention to kill, covered under murder. Okay? Very clear. The second will be again relating to intention. Intention to cause such bodily injury. The stress is on the word intention. So that is the second part. So there are three aspects to it. One, intention to cause, intention to kill straight away. The second, intention to inflict bodily injury as is likely to cause death. Intention. Again, I stress, both relating to intention. Intention to kill, intention to cause such bodily injury as is likely to cause death. Third, there is one more aspect to it. Knowledge. Two aspects relating to intention, one aspect relating to knowledge. Knowledge, what is that knowledge? Knowledge that death must be the most probable result of the injury. So knowledge of that nature. So two aspects of intention, one aspect of knowledge. Bring it within the ambit of murder. Okay. Now I go to culpable homicide. So this is culpable homicide amounting to murder. So I have carved out one situation. The second situation now I am carving out is culpable homicide not amounting to murder. Now what are those acts? Those acts relate only to knowledge. There is no intention there. And what is the knowledge? The knowledge is that death will be the likely result. So this I have carved out the next scenario, culpable homicide not amounting to murder. So these are two sets which I have just carved out for you in relation to 299 and 300 and 304. Because this portion, wherein I spoke about culpable homicide not amounting to murder, where the aspect of knowledge I had spoken, is what is punishable under 304. 304 in itself is not creating any offense. It is talking about the punishment. And this punishment in relation to this portion. So what is 304A? Because death is happening in 304A as well. So these are two different kinds of deaths, if I may say so. State of mind, the mens rea, is different. So wherever intention and knowledge can be attributed to the act, 304A will not come into operation. If knowledge and intention can be attributed to the act is reus, 304A will not come into the picture. Understood? So now having said that, let us see what is a rash and negligent act. Right? So we move on, because I came to the conceptual part first and now I am moving on. Rash act as distinguished from a wanton act. A rash act is an act which is done hastily, without deliberation and caution, do it in great haste. What also it includes? It includes a state of mind that you are taking a chance. You are taking a chance in that haste. That yes, I am going to do a dangerous act. But with the knowledge that in doing so, I may cause injury. That knowledge is there. Risk layer. Right? For instance, Hariharan travels, he gets up late in the morning. Court starts at 10:30. He moves out of home at 10:15. He knows that there is traffic on the way. He tells his driver, drive as fast as you can. Doesn't matter. Jump a few red lights. I have to reach court by 10:30. That is my dictum to you. You bring me there at that point of time. Rash act. I know probably with the speed at which Sonu is driving, my driver is driving, I may land up hitting someone. Though I have no intention to do so. But I run the risk. I run the risk. Till now nothing has happened by God's grace. But it may happen. So when you drive fast, without regard to the safety signs on the way, you jump red lights, you overtake from the left side, which we all do in Delhi. We are all committing rash acts. We are cognizant of the fact that what we are doing is not correct. And then we flash our eye cards and consider the fact that we are lawyers, so we have immunity. We are actually indulging in rash acts. We are somewhere at the back of our mind, we know what we are doing is not right, but we are running the risk. So then, how is this rash act different from a culpably negligent act? See, a negligent act is that there is a kind of a duty cast on the person doing it. There is a legal obligation on the said person. That legal obligation he fails to comply. And if it is a positive legal compulsion, that positive legal compulsion is not complying. If it is a negative legal compulsion, which he should not be doing, he is doing it. And when he is doing such an act, he is doing that without exercising reasonable and proper care. He is supposed to exercise care and caution. He is not exercising that caution. So it's a deliberate act from his end. Now this will have culpability attached to it. And the culpability, because negligence has got other dimensions to it. It has got a tortious dimension. It has also got a civil dimension. But when I am talking about culpability here, this is the criminal culpability that I am talking of. Now, how to explain this? There is a very interesting landmark case. S.N. Hussain versus State of UP, State of Andhra Pradesh. AIR 1972, Supreme Court, 685. That was a very interesting case. Again, generally seen happening in our country. Because ours is a country where one, the Indian Railway expanded over a period of time and it reached many places. There, the roadways also came in, the road structure also started expanding. There were situations where the roads and the rails crossed each other, and where they crossed each other, there were level crossings which were made. The railways created level crossings, and of course the train was given a preference. So these level crossings all over the country generally are manned, but there are places where they are unmanned as well. Now this case which I am talking of relates to the driver of a bus which was in Andhra Pradesh, which was moving from a place called Karnool and going to another place called Vanaparthi in Andhra Pradesh. So while moving from Karnool onwards, it basically went in the route, en route, there was a level crossing. The level crossing also had a traffic signal. The idea of a traffic signal initially was that the bus will come to a halt and then thereafter move across. But the level crossing which was there was a manned level crossing. When the bus came towards this direction, the level crossing was open. The guard had kept it open. And this was a bus route, a state bus route, which was plying on this more or less every day. The driver took the bus across. The level crossing was at a height, and there were certain trees, clumps of trees close by. So the driver obviously could not see past the clumps of trees. He saw the gate open and he was crossing. The bus, because it was a lengthy straight roadways bus, had gone past, half the bus had gone past, and then suddenly some passengers realized that a goods train had come, all of a sudden. And by the time some of them say that they did raise an alarm, but the bus was already more than halfway through. It is the case of the driver that he tried to speed past, but the train hit the back side of the bus and two persons lost their lives and some of them got injured. So it's a typical case where the act was considered to be rash and negligent in terms of 279 and 304A. Now I come to the second concept. The concept is this, that as far as rashness and negligence are concerned, these will depend on the circumstances. The circumstances which attenuate the event. Now the question out here, why I said this is a celebrated case, because it deals with these aspects. The concepts of rashness and the concept of negligence was discussed and expounded in great detail. I gave you the facts in general. The trial court acquitted the driver of both the offences. The High Court reversed the judgment. The High Court returned a finding saying this, that no, as far as the driver was concerned, the driver was rash and negligent. Reason being that one, there was a traffic signal. He should have brought the bus to a dead halt there and he should have looked around, which he did not do. Then it also considered the evidence wherein there were some passengers who said that they made lazy the hue and cry when they saw the goods train coming. And they apprised him. But he took the bus across, which was negated by none less than an inspector who was sitting right next to the driver, who said that he could not hear anybody demonstrating from behind. And by the time they realized that there was a goods train, the bus was halfway. And the driver sped the bus, but unfortunately, the train rammed it. Now look at the manner in which the Supreme Court analyzes the circumstances. The first thing the Supreme Court said was that, look, it was a manned level crossing, which means that there was a person who was there, there was a guard there. Now as far as the guard was concerned, he kept the gates open. Second, this was a state road transport bus which was used to plying on this route every day. Now, interestingly, it was hit by a goods train. A goods train does not have a definite timing of coming. So, it could not have been reasonably expected of the driver to have anticipated the coming of this train. This train came, it was not scheduled, it came unscheduled. Unlike a passenger train which has got a regular timing and a regular route. Or it should have been a train which the on the same route it used to come on at that very point of time and the driver was used to it. It was not that. He was not chancing his arm. If the level crossing was unmanned, the situation would have been different. Thirdly, he said that the High Court went wrong in attributing, because the test which is to be applied is that of a reasonable man. The test which is to be applied is not of an extraordinary person. The test is always that of a reasonable person, of a normal human being. Whether in normal circumstances, what is it that you could do? And did you take all those precautions which a normal man would take? And he said that since 3/4 of the bus had already gone past, or half the bus had gone past, he had no option but to speed from there, which he speeded, which also shows that there was no negligent conduct on his part. And rashness cannot be attributed to him because the level crossing was unmanned. The level crossing was open, it was a manned level crossing, and the opening of the level crossing would show that there was no impending train coming. So here, there was no deliberate act wherein he was hazarding something. He did not do any dangerous act. Why One can understand if there, it was an unmanned level crossing and he took the bus across. Then there was this knowledge in his mind that there could be a train which would come. He could get hit. So that was lacking out here. But interestingly, now if you look at it from the other dimension, the other dimension is this, that there was no intention out here to kill. When I take you back to 299 and 300, here, because deaths did happen, two deaths took place. But did the driver of the bus have the intention or the knowledge as is required of in relation to 299 and 300? The answer is no. One which I just explained to you. So therefore, this would be a case which would fit under 304A and 304A alone in terms of allegations. So ultimately, the Supreme Court acquitted him, the driver of all charges. And interestingly, this was one of those cases where the Supreme Court said that here is a scenario where the guard is not being held responsible. You make a case out against the driver, but you don't make a case against the guard. Now the other matter which I wish to, you know, also expound when I am dealing with these concepts. There is a very interesting case, and this is again an old case, by the name of Empress versus Idu Bek. This is 1881. This happened in 1881. 1881, 3 Allahabad, 776. Now this is a typical matter, and the facts are very interesting, and of course all that I had said also is talked about in that case. The facts are such that Idu Bey would have occasional fights with his wife. One of those occasions when he had a fight, and when he had a fight on that occasion, he suddenly in a fit of rage picked up a heavy wooden object and hit her on the left side. And as luck would have it, she bled from her nose, fell down, senseless, and died. Now in this kind of a scenario, a postmortem was done. The coroner returned a finding that she had a slightly enlarged spleen, And the death happened due to a ruptured spleen. Now here came the question as to what was the offense which was committed. Interestingly, a charge was framed under 304A. With an alternative charge of 302. The trial court returned a finding that it was a rash and negligent act and punished Idu Bek under 304A. When this came up on appeal, the court had the occasion to examine this, and as I had elucidated a little earlier, it spoke about 299 and 300, examined the situations in relation to that, and applied the test. And interestingly, because here is a scenario where he was not aware at any point of time that his wife had an enlarged spleen. That knowledge could not be attributed to him. But 304A, again, when you look at 304A, the kind of deaths which are essentially contemplated in 304A, within that ambit, it is something, of course, which is not within the subsets which I had earlier demarcated of 299 and 300, where their intention and knowledge in relation to cause death or injury of that nature, or knowledge that that kind of injury would be caused, would be in play. But here was a scenario where the knowledge was not there. But here was also a scenario that this was not that kind of an injury, because he had intention and he had knowledge out here to cause an injury which would affect the person bodily. There was an intention and knowledge to cause injury out here. So therefore, this was not something which could have been covered under 304A as a rash and negligent act. There was an intention to cause injury. So depending on the nature of the injury which a hard object would cause, in this case the court rightfully came to a conclusion that it would come within the ambit of 325. Because there are those provisions in relation to hurt, grievous or otherwise, which also needs to be looked into in terms of the state of mind when that act causing that injury is being done. So therefore, by causing this injury, Idu Bey committed an offence under 325. So that's how it was dealt with. So why I am giving these examples? I am trying to draw out those distinctions for you, that how the state of mind is different. Though resultant death would have been caused, but the intention to cause that injury was different. Now there are certain things, you know, even in relation to negligence, when we talk in terms of injury cause, there is a concept called causa causans. What does this causa causans mean? This causa causans is a concept which in a way talks about the fact that there is a proximate or an immediate connection between the act and the injury which results, or the death that is resulting in case of 304A, it's a question of death. So the act should be the proximate cause. There should not be anything intervening in between. For instance, if you look at the Idu Bey's example itself for a minute, here it was the enlarged spleen, right? A rupture to the spleen was caused because of the fact that it was enlarged. So there was some kind of an intervening factor there, if you look at it from that dimension, though the judgment doesn't look at it from that dimension, but from the facts I am trying to bring you that dimension. So therefore, in the case of negligence, or in the case of rashness and negligence put together, the incident should have a proximate connection with the act committed. There should not be any intervening factor. Now, various kinds of culpability gets attracted when you talk in terms of negligence, because of the fact that law has evolved over a period of time. Medical negligence, for instance. You see, all of you go to doctors. You have heard of instances where the doctor left his scalpel inside or sewed up the person post the injury with the scalpel inside, or he left a few sanitary napkins inside or something like that. There have been instances where death has resulted. So here the question is, one of the tests here will be that whether death happened due to that connect, was there that proximate connect, number one. Two, interestingly, also one of the things which I spoke a little earlier, the test is that of a reasonable man. The test is not that, for instance, if it is a doctor, what a doctor of that level is expected, a normal doctor of that level is expected, that is the test which is applied. You see? To attribute negligence, because it should be somebody who has done everything, he has taken due care and diligence in doing what he does, And yet a scenario may happen, which may be beyond his means. Those aspects are given concession of when the law looks into it. The test is that of a reasonable man. It is not that of an extraordinary person, which is to be applied. There is landmark, famous case where you will find all this. There is Jacob Matthews versus State of Punjab. Citation I will refer to you, I am not offhand remembering. But there is a landmark judgment of the Supreme Court, which deals specially with situations of medical negligence. But why medical negligence? I am talking in terms of all experts for a minute. Any person who is supposed to be a professional. Even lawyers may be covered in the ambit after a while. Right now, because of the fact that you people had clout or you had Mr. Jaitley around, they let you off. Now you don't have Jaitley, and if you have a government which is going to tighten the noose against lawyers, you will also find yourself in the dock. So the question is that there can be professional negligence. So the word is professional negligence and not medical negligence alone. The test will more or less be the same. Whether it be an architect, whether it be an engineer, whether it be a lawyer, whether it be any of the professionals who offer your specialized services in relation to a particular field, where you claim yourself to be an expert. So the test which is propounded is that of an ordinary person, number one. Now, what does it factor in? Where do you have the defense for yourself? Right? Some kind of a defense you will need, no? Because every case that you lose, if you are in this ambit, you will have a case against you saying that you were professionally negligent. There was negligence. Culpable negligence. Saurabh Soni did not defend me properly. He got me a life sentence. Come on. So there will be a case of culpable negligence against you. Or say, Webber did this, he is a culpable negligence against him, or so forth. And so, all these people who are attending this lecture, all of us, including Hariharan, the only escape for Hariharan is that he doesn't sign a Vakalatnama. So he can pass it on to one of you guys. So coming back to it, jokes apart. So what is the difference that is available? The difference that is available is that the law gives you the concession of an error of judgment. There can be a genuine error of judgment. You see, when, for example, any one of you cross-examines a witness, you have a game plan in your mind. Maybe the game plan is right, maybe the game plan is not right. There can be an error of judgment. Varun asked a question in a particular fashion, expecting that he will get this answer. He got some other answer. So can you make him culpable for that? So I will draw, I will try and explain this by way of something where these kind of situations get confronted and there is a matter. If you people remember, the Delhi Metro scenario a few years ago, if you people remember, there was a metro pillar which fell on the way towards Greater Kailash. There was an accident there. And in relation to the said accident, the same provisions were invoked. Now, interestingly, when the pillar fell, actually what had happened was that there were these two pillars. In relation to the two pillars, a span was to be placed. The pillars, they hold portions which are prefabricated. That span was to be placed, and in relation to the span, the length of the span was a little more. So they had used a different kind of a device out there. They had run all the tests which were required. And the way the metro functions is that the metro actually contracts portions of its construction to various constructing engineering agencies, including design firms. So there was a design firm which was involved, there was a contractor who was involved, and there was the Metro Railway Corporation also, whose engineer and people who were working under him were also involved in relation to the supervision part. Now the designs were submitted, the designs were tested, and the designs were found. And since the loop which was there, it was a lengthy loop which was being done for the first time, tested principles of engineering were considered, and they found that the design fault was not there, the design was okay, and they decided to implement that new design. Now, during the course of the implementation, when the pillars were erected, the span was not lowered onto the pillars at the moment. They found that on one of the pillars, certain cracks were coming. Now, when certain cracks come up, there could be various reasons for the said cracks. So, what the engineers did when evidence of these cracks came up, they decided that at that point of time, they will hold any further happenings in relation to the two pillars. And they decided that they would monitor the cracks by putting glass pieces into the cracks. That is the way it is done. So, if the cracks expand, or if the cracks are not superficial cracks and the cracks go further deep, then those glass pieces will give way, which is an indicator. That is the manner in which they do it. So, that was done and it was looked into. The cracks did not go further. They also tested the cement and the core of the pillar to find out whether proper proportions were used, proper amount of cement was used, proper amount of, you know, iron was used as far as the structure was concerned for building the foundation. All those tests were carried out. All those tests stood to the standards. There is a basic manual of procedure. That procedure, all that was stated in the procedure was also followed. But amongst one of the things, and what they did, they also called in experts who are known experts in the said field. They were also consulted and they were asked, and these methodologies were prescribed by the said experts. Experts who are like Modi in jurisprudence, experts of that level. They came and okayed the entire thing, saying that okay, things are fine. So, after having given a gap of around 15 days or 20 days or a month, and after having done all this in between, the concerned expert said that you can go ahead. He gave a go ahead. Interestingly, now, whenever a situation like this happens, the manual also provides that before doing lowering the span, you can also go in for what is known as a load test. Now, that was a call which was to be taken. But the load test was not done. They decided to go ahead with placing the span without doing the load test because they felt that all other tests had been done, which indicates that everything, engineering standards were adhered to. Structurally, the structure was okay. The cracks did not give any evidence of the fact that they needed to explore anything further. And since the Delhi Metro functions with a particular time constraint of executing projects within a particular point of time, and considering the fact that all measures had been taken and the expert had also okayed it, they decided, the engineers, the chief engineer and the others decided not to go for the load test. And they decided that the span would be lowered. Now, as things would have it, when the span was lowered, once the span was lowered, an accident happened. And in the said accident, some lives were lost. The pillar failed, the span failed. There was a loss of life and the cases were registered. Now, here comes the question which I was talking of in terms of negligence. And that is what is being looked into apart from other aspects. That whether one, the test of a reasonable man in those circumstances when it is applied as per Jacob Matthews' case also, whether everything that was expected was done of a reasonable person. number one. And number two, whenever a professional is at work, you see, now for instance, a lawyer is at work, you in a civil matter or in a criminal matter, you have a case which the prosecution is alleging against you. Are you entitled to take a defense which you think would be the right defense in your case? The question which begs an answer is this, that yes, you at that point of time, it depends on your skill, based on your skill, based on your experience, based on the probabilities over a period of time, that considered choice you are given, you are entitled to take a defense. Multiple defenses can be taken during the course of a trial. What is the defense that you will take, depending on the fact scenario of a particular case, is the judgment which is given to you as a professional. Now, there can be an error of that judgment. Now, here is a scenario. When we apply that out here, in this case, the test is this, that whether it was an error of judgment or it was a case of negligence. Whether the load test should have been carried out or whether it could have been dispensed with, and whether this plea that it was an error of judgment will hold good or not. Say for example, in the case of an operation, a person comes with an ailment, say a heart ailment. A heart ailment, there are blockages in the arteries. Now when he comes, the call has to be taken by the doctor at that point of time, whether the blockage is of such a nature which can be treated by way of medicines, or is it something which will require a surgical intervention. That call is to be taken by the cardiac surgeon or the cardiologist. Either way, supposing the cardiologist says that there is no need to go for a surgery and I can treat this with medicines, and he gives statins or whatever is being given for that. But yet, despite treatment, the patient succumbs. Will the doctor be liable for negligence? Or would he have the defense of error of judgment? Similarly, a surgeon says that, alright, there seems to be blockage of around say 60%, and I feel that the best way is to remove that blockage. And I have done hundreds of operations, and I have done them successfully. I'll operate you, there will be no problem. So onto the table, and on the table, anything can happen. It was a call which the doctor had to take. He took the call, the patient expired. So that is why they say operation successful but patient dead. It's generally used. So it's an error of judgment. If you people recollect, it happened with our Justice Valmiki Mehta. The call was taken that an operation could be done. It was a minor operation. They said minor operation done. He was even discharged. He went home and he died. It's an error of judgment. Hundreds of operations, they say one in a million situation happens like this. Similarly, one in a million situation, you are not supposed to anticipate. One in a million situation happens when a pillar will fall. When the standards which are established in terms of any profession are adhered to and something happens against the set standard, it's an extraordinary situation. But it will be on you to show that all the reasonable care and due diligence which was required was done by you. That onus will be on you. So here comes the second question, that in this kind of a case, whether a discharge can be merited. Now this is a question which I have to answer, not you people have to answer. But yes, these kind of questions do arise. So with that, I will conclude this particular session on these various states of mind. And I think more or less comprehensively we have dealt with all of them. the next session, I will move on to another aspect as and when it takes place, and it will relate to stages in relation to the commission of a crime. I will deal.